And so joining us is George Washington Hunt, served as a naval officer, consultant to major companies, headed up with the World Conservation Societies, World Conservation Bank, was a big part of that, working with the United Nations. He's done so much out of the gates here. I just want Mr. Hunt to give us a nutshell overview, a thumbnail sketch of himself, how he got involved with these groups, then how he woke up to what they were really doing, not just in their speeches, but the on-the-side meetings and discussions of the establishment of world government through phony environmentalism. So, George Hunt, it's great to have you here with us today.
I'm glad to be here, Alex. Every chance I get to spread the bad news, that's my job.
Well, you know, people sometimes...
I went to the Fourth World Wilderness Congress at September 11th, 1987. I went there because my son had been killed in a wilderness area later part of the year, or about a few months before, and I was very, very sad. And also my other son that was still living said he wanted to repair huts along the Arctic for travelers, and he wanted to get into a job. So I heard the Fourth World Wilderness was coming to town, and with all its reindeer and pretty little bright lights, and I said, you know, maybe I could go there and rub shoulders with the Smokies, with the forest rangers, and get my son a job. And so I went down to the Congress, and I saw the pictures of the reindeer and so on. But then I noticed on the program that there was another aspect away from Denver. The first 2 days of this Wilderness Congress is supposed to be pro-conservation. The first 2 days were in Denver, and then they moved a quasi-secret meeting up to the YMCA of Estes Park, Colorado. So, with my resourceful mind, I said to myself, I'd like to get into that Congress, but I didn't have any money. And then, lo and behold, I got the information that one of the official hosts of the meeting was ill with the flu. I got his number. I called him. He says, yeah, take my place. I was interviewed by about four people. Among them were psychics, and they approved me as an official host.
Now, that shows how weird these groups are, because Maurice Strong also has a wilderness retreat like Bohemian Grove, similar, where they admittedly do a lot of bizarre activities. So everywhere they go, there's always psychics and the occult involved.
Yes. Well, they were involved here, too, Alex. They all run together. The psychics, the cults, the witches, the devils, the near rich that want to get into the crowd. It's a whole mishmash.
And there's video of this that you shot. I mean, over time, you became the leader of the conferences, and we're going to get into that, how these twists of fate got you in this position. So we're going to break in a moment. Let's come back with George Hunt goes. He wants a spot at this event, this conservation event. You end up getting one of the places of one of the hosts, and then suddenly you're with Rothschilds, Rockefellers. How did this happen? You're approved by psychics to be able to go by them. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. And I've done separate research from George Hunt confirming what he said about Maurice Strong and others. They want a one-world religion, as Al Gore is now openly saying. We'll be right back with George Hunt.
To meet the man who pulls together all the threads, George Hunt.
Not truly really about saving the planet from carbon dioxide. It's about making money at an international level. We're not even talking here about country. We're talking about a global type money-making thing, correct?
Yes. We're talking about a powerful, immense aristocracy that has the intention of using the fear of the environment deteriorating. They're going to use it to take over the world.
George Hunt was an official at the World Wilderness Congress when he met Maurice Strong in 1987. The Congress is an international forum for discussing the environment. But Maurice Strong showed up to introduce a new player, financier Edmond Rothschild of the Rothschild banking dynasty, and a proposal to create something called a World Conservation Bank.
One of the most important initiatives that is open here is that of the conservation banking program. We have as our chairman, fortunately, the person who epitomizes that positive synthesis between environment, conservation on the one hand, and economics on the other. And I'm just delighted to have this opportunity of introducing to you Edmond de Rothschild.
Maurice Strong was in charge of the conservation movement, but he was also Edmond de Rothschild's right-hand man. You have money and the environment in one person, okay. Edmond de Rothschild. Now, Maurice Strong, I found out during the...
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're back live the rest of the hour, a little bit in the next hour. George Hunt is our guest to go in depth. So he's just looking into conservation jobs for his son. One of the presenters is sick. He says, I'd like to go. Suddenly he's being vetted by them, by psychics. And from my separate research, this is on record, Maurice Strong has a weird cult compound in Colorado. It ties into Bohemian Grove. The UN, of course, is into the occult. He brought that up. That's coming up later. Okay, going back to George Hunt, naval officer, corporate businessman, successful. He gets involved in this, and over the next few years, going to these events, and it turns out chairing some of them, he finds out what's really going on. So continue with, you get into this first semi-secret, closed-door meeting in Colorado. Continue from there, George Hunt.
Yes, I had luncheon with the Rothschilds. They were very nice people. Lady Rothschild stood up when I came to the table, and she filled my glass. And suddenly I said, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. My cup runneth over. And I was with the president of the World Conservation Bank. And I said, Michael Sweetman, how is this bank going to survive if the asset base is Arctic lands? They don't produce any dividends and interest. He says, oh, we are worried. We are working on that, he said in his precise English. I said, you're working on it, and you're going to have a seminar and a half an hour where you're going to accept this bank? What's going on, Michael? He said, you'll have a chance to ask us at the seminar. I looked him in the eye. I said, Michael, are you going to call on me? Look me in the eye, Michael. Yes, I promise. Well, we went to the seminar, and of course, he didn't call on me. It was a contrived Congress, and they accepted the bank. And we haven't seen it yet, but it's coming down the road. There will be one bank, one credit card, one of everything. And if you cross that bank and don't do what they want or the owners want, you'll lose your credit card privilege, and you won't be able to buy or sell.
Now, let's fast forward 24 years or 23 years to 2010. I now have London Guardian, Associated Press headlines, Rothschild's established global environment bank, Rothschild's established global carbon credit bank. It's now mainstream news, what you whistleblew on decades ago after you got deeper into the groups. We're going to cover that they were going to establish all this, and everything you said, of course, you also released the documents and video and audio, but everything you talked about was going to happen is now actually happening.
Yes, that's what I want people to wake up at. This is a conspiracy going on. It's no longer a conspiracy theory. It's a conspiracy fact.
Okay, so continue. So you're at the meeting. You're at the table with the Rothschilds because by twist of fate, you got the ticket or the seat of one of the presenters who had the flu. Go ahead.
Then my fellow workers came up to me and they said, George, we have to talk to you about something. David Rockefeller has sent us a message that if you don't keep your mouth shut, you're going to regret it. Shortly after that, after the meeting, I was talking with a talk show host, and he said, did you get Guillain-Barre syndrome yet? And I said, what are you talking about? He said, GBS, it seems like everyone that gets close to the bone with world order gets it. Well, I just got out of the hospital with GBS. So there's something there, don't you think?
Oh, we know they have a lot of programs with soft kill weapons, but expanding on this, because you got the video out of there at other events. So out of the gate,
I got the tape of the events. As far as I know, it's the only tape in existence.
And I've seen video of them presenting, audio of them presenting. So it looks like out of the gates, and correct me if I'm wrong, you were confrontational with them immediately. Maybe that's why they kept you around for a while, trying to get control of you, worried that you'd gotten into a secret meeting that you weren't supposed to be part of. Or why didn't they kick you out? Why did you get invited to more meetings?
I can't figure that out. First of all, I hadn't done anything wrong, though. I was an official host, and I was.
So why was David Rockefeller telling you to shut up?
With people.
Why was
I had regular association with Maurice Strong there?